Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through.
Toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way.
Cause the drinks bring back all the memories. And the memories bring.
Oh, me lads, you should have seen them running. Asked the why and they replied, the boats and boys are coming. All the lads and lasses, smiles upon their faces, walking down the Marnie Road to see the burnt in aces. Oh, me lads, you sure to see them running. Ask them why and they replied, the boats and boys are coming. All the lads and lasses, smiles upon their faces, we're walking down the Marnie Road to see the burnt in aces.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to our usual Sunday stream. It's great to be with you tonight. We've got an absolute legend with us tonight, and what a lovely fella he is. Does a lot for the community, charities. One of our best wingers ever. Absolute superb bloke. We'll get him on in a short time. A few shout-outs. Want to send our love to Paul Stones. Ladies, his dad to rest this week, John. So condolences and love to Stonesy and all his family. Also this week, the Vulcan Whites, Dean Whites, are burying... laying to rest Billy Atherton, and I believe that the funeral's being streamed live. So if you want the link for that, just DM Twiggy, because Twiggy were a big mate of his, and he'll get it over to you. Also, another funeral, unfortunately. Gary Flatcap, Gary, come on, yeah, I'm trying to say that with your teeth in. Gary Flatcap Yates, his funeral's this week as well. Gary used to, I went on a few of Gary's excursions. Oh, an absolutely lovely fella. So just keep your eye open on the remembrance group, and any details that come up, I'm sure Hagee will put them up, because Hagee was a massive pal of his. Now then, we've got to do, I've put a link on the remembrance group. The reason we formed this group, as you all know, was for my mate, stroke brother, Al Packy Perkin. And what we're going to do, we're going to lay his rest, lay his ashes, spread his ashes, whatever you want. What we're hoping to do is get the ground open with the bar open and have it in the part of ground where we all used to sit, which is the West Stand. And after that, we're going to have a piss up, knees up, whatever you want to call it. Obviously, we're going to have to see what the numbers are, and that's what I want you to do. If you want to come, stick in that you want to come to the ground and the do, or just the ground, and then I can get the numbers and get a big enough venue sorted. Last thing is we've announced our we've launched our website, and we've got to thank Mr. David Southern for that. He's done an absolutely fantastic job. You'll see the website address is will be going across the screen later in the stream. So go and have a look at that. Anything you want to add or change, or, you know, just send us your comments and let's get it how we want. We put loads of BWFC footage on, and we put loads of Remembrance tributes on. So have a look at it, share it, and see where you go from there. Right, let's bring Mr. Twigster in now. Let him do his little bit.
Hi, guys. Welcome to the stream. Be a cracker tonight with a legend, David Lee. Just before I go on to the announcements, condolences with Paul Stones and his family. He'd laid his dad to rest, just on the back of what Al said. Yeah, Billy Atherton, he was a big mate of mine up from Dean White. So funeral tomorrow. So as Al said, if anybody wants the link, it's screen live. Let me know, and thoughts and condolences to Charlotte and the family. Just before I get onto the stream, onto the sponsor, all our future streams from April are going to be on the third Sunday of each month. So, yeah, keep an eye out for that. The next one is April 18th, and it's going to be with Peter Reid. Well, again, it'll be a cracker. Right, onto this week's sponsor, which is the Sparkle Cabin. They have a Facebook page, and they basically do fantastic work on photos, you know, they can revamp them up. Absolutely brilliant what they do. And they can, you know, if you supply a canvas, a portrait, anything like that, they'll revamp it. They'll even supply them as well, even great competitive prices. But if you look at the work, it's absolutely fantastic what they do. They really enhance it so much. It really brings the photo out. So give the Facebook page a visit. Hit the old like button, but anything you need on it, obviously message them, but they do an absolutely fantastic job. So here's a little video of what they do.
You remember me when the west wind moves among the fields of barley. You can tell the sun in his jealous sky when we walked in fields of gold. So she took her love for to gaze awhile among the fields of barley. In his arms she fell as her hair came down among the fields of gold. Will you stay? And you can tell the sun in his jealous sky when we walked in fields of gold. I never made promises lightly, and there have been some that I've broken, but I swear in the days still we'll walk in fields of gold.
Okay, I'll hand you back to Alpha now.
All right, thank you. Let's welcome our first admin. He's just opened a memorabilia shop. If you want to go buy some stuff, just nip round, he'll take you in his bedroom, Mr. Steve Haig.
Right, hey, everybody. Thanks for coming on to tonight's live stream. Thanks to the Sparkle Cabin for sponsoring tonight's stream. All our thoughts are going out to Paul Stones and his family, for laying his father to rest this week. And obviously, everybody knew Gary Flatcap off Fallowall Road. What a lad. What an absolutely unbelievable sound lad. Taken far too young from us. His funeral's on Tuesday. I believe it's about 12 o'clock. The cortege will be going up Alloa Road, past the Raglan, past Last Orders, over to the crematorium. There is a link on the group page. They've set a group page up for Gary Yates. There'll be a link on to, so you can actually view the service in the crematorium, because obviously not many's going to be able to get inside, but I should imagine that there's hundreds going to be outside lining Alloa Road. So all our thoughts are with his family and his mother and everybody else who's going.
Let's get a bit of showbiz, a bit of entertainment on, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Johnny Vegas, a.k.a. Darren Mansfield. All right, Paul. Try turning your sound on, Darren. It might work better.
Sorry, mate.
There you go. Technical
difficulties.
Your turn this week.
It's me instead of you, Al, but don't worry about it.
Yeah, it does.
Good evening, everybody. We'll start again. Get that clapperboard out. Take 27. I hope everybody's all right and keeping well during these lockdown times. Condolences, obviously, to the people that have lost loved ones in the past week or so, and obviously they're being laid to rest. I hope you enjoy tonight's stream.
Brilliant. Well done, Daz. Okay. Thanks, Daz. You've seen our four old glamours, but this is the man you've tuned in for. What a man, what a legend, Mr. David Lee. Hi, David.
Good evening, everybody.
How are you doing, mate?
Absolutely
great, thank you.
Absolutely brilliant to have you on, mate. What an honour. We'll be having, what we generally do is just go through your go through your career and go through your career, play a few videos, have a bit of fun, quiz and stuff like that, and some questions off the lads actually live watching the stream now. So
brilliant. Looking forward to it. It's a pleasure to be on. It really is.
Brilliant. Thanks for that. Well, have you got your screen up there? I've got your 501 appearances and 64 goals.
Yeah, I've got that right in front of me.
Yeah.
Many moons ago, Al.
Many moons ago, pal. Yeah, but happy days. Happy days.
Where does that time go?
Brilliant. I know. People say if you could go back, a lot of lads say 58, but it's at Anfield for me all day long.
Definitely.
Yeah, I mean, it's written in the history for the club. It was a fantastic night for the supporters and the club itself and the town and the supporters. And you know what? It's fantastic how we still talk about it. And it's, what, 26, 27 years ago, maybe a bit longer now.
Well,
it's brilliant. It really is. But you know what? That's one memory that I've got. But from the football club's perspective, from being there for the length of time I've been there, I've had some great times and some great memories. I met a lot of nice people. Met a lot of nice friends along the way as well.
Well, you give us a lot of happy memories as well, pal. The class is one of our own, so there you go. So, right, got a few pictures for you there, pal. You can talk us through.
Wow. I don't wear that tie anymore when I was at school. No, that brings back great memories, that. Obviously, the one with the tie on there, it was my first tie at Gregson Lane County Primary Junior School many, many moons ago. I think I was 4 when I started, so that's, what, 49 years ago. So I've had to raid my mum's cupboard to get that picture for us tonight.
Brilliant. Superb. Yeah. You were born in Whitefield, weren't you?
Yes, yeah. My parents were living in Whitefield. I was born in Whitefield, and then we only spent maybe a couple of years there, and then my parents moved over to the Preston area through work, and that's where I grew up, in a little village called Horton. It's Horton Tower, spelled Hoghton, which is between Chorley, Preston and Blackburn, right in the hub of those three towns. Yeah. That's where I did my growing up and playing my football there.
Superb. Yeah, and we've got a couple of your school teams on there, haven't we? You got you in a blue shirt with your medal. And
Do you know, the one with the medal there, that was for my local Sunday league team, Gregson Lane. And John McGinley, like this, we actually played in the Scotland kit.
Yeah.
Yeah. But might I just say, we were better than Scotland when we were that age.
Yeah. Right, let's start when you went pro. Like, we started there. Who spotted you for Bury then, Dave? Where were you spotted?
Right, well, it's quite a long story, really. But I was a schoolboy at Blackburn Rovers from the age of 12, which you could sign as an associate schoolboy. And I signed for Blackburn Rovers at the age of 12, and they took me all the way through to under-15s, under-16s level. And then, obviously, they had to make a decision on whether you're going to be given what they called an apprenticeship then. And I missed out on that apprenticeship. So I thought it was the end of the world and the end of my footballing career. So I actually stepped away from the game, and I had a great mate at school, a lad called Simon Duckworth. And his parents used to go to Cornwall to St Ives every year on holiday. And he said to me, David, why don't we go down to Cornwall and live on the beach, or try and get a job down there when we leave school? Because we weren't going to go to college with no further education to go to, and I had no career to go into. So I said, okay, we'll do it. So as soon as we finished our last exam, we booked a bus journey all the way to St Ives. We went from Preston to Birmingham to Bristol and then to St Ives. It took us about 11 hours on the coach or the bus to get there. And we ended up renting a little flat above a fruit and veg shop in St Ives. And we stayed there for about 6 or 7 weeks. And we worked for the shop, and we worked for the cafe on Porthmere Beach in St Ives. and I was literally getting up at 5 o'clock in the morning. We had a shovel each and a bag, and we had to dig and collect the seaweed from the storms the night before for the beach to be clean. And then people could come on, all the customers and holidaymakers could come on the beach. And that's what we started doing. Wow. And then I'd finish work and maybe 6-7 o'clock when the sun had gone down, all the punters had gone home. And the lad who owned the shop said, "Oh, David, your mum's rung you. Can you give her a ring?" But no mobile phones in them days. So I said to my mate, "Simon, can you lend me 50p to ring my mum?" So we went to the local telephone kiosk, put some money in, said, "Mum, what did you want? Blah, blah, blah." She went, "Oh, there's somebody called Martin Dobson rung me, asking if you want to come for a trial to Bury." I went, "Mum, I'm 11 hours away. When is it?" She went, "Well, it's tomorrow." So I said to my mate, I said, "Listen, Sam," I said, "it might be the only chance I ever get. What do you think I should do?" He said, "Go." So I got up at 5 o'clock the following morning and I got on the reverse bus trip all the way back to Preston. My mum picked me up and I had to be at Gig Lane the following morning at 9 o'clock. So I travelled all day to get home. So I had an old pair of boots. My mum said, "Right, get on the train, get on the buses, get to Bury and see what you can do." So I reported to Gig Lane on that, I think it was a Thursday morning. And a bloke called Steve Walsh, used to work for Leicester City in Everton, said, "Right, David, go and get changed in there. We're down at Lower Gig at 10 o'clock, kick off. We'll see you down at Lower Gig." So they provided us with his kit, walked down to Lower Gig, which is about half a mile walk, in my boots, studs on. Everybody there, kicked off, game kicked off. I'm playing on the right wing. 4.5-5 minutes later, whistle blows. "David, come off." Oh, God, brilliant. Wow. I've travelled 11 hours for 4.5-5 minutes football. So the rest of the game played, and they had 3 30-minute periods, and the game finished, and Steve Wall said to everybody, "Right, get yourself back up to the training ground, to the ground at Gig Lane, get showered, get changed, whatever. Thank you very much." So we all trooped off and I walked off, got my kit on, got changed, just walking down the corridor to go out, and someone said, "Oh, David, the manager wants to see you just to say thank you." I thought, that's courteous of him. I went in the office and it was Martin Dobson. He went, "I'd like to offer you an apprenticeship."
Wow.
I went, "I've only played 4.5 minutes. He went, "Soon enough, I wanted to be an apprentice." And that's how my career started as a footballer.
Excellent. Brilliant. It's amazing, really, when you're thinking about it, why I've been doing the script and that this week, and it, like, just comes... I mean, don't get me wrong. I think proper for football supporters, and you get a few dickheads, like, but felt for Bury when they went under. Because especially with us being so close as well, we were only a matter of hours. I think people forget about that sometimes, but when you think about it, it's like not even 4 or 5 mile, and you were a legend in both towns and still are.
But you know what? Both clubs have got a place in my heart, because Bury were the club who gave me an opportunity to become a professional footballer, and I had 6.5 fantastic years there with some success, and I played with some fantastic footballers, and the infrastructure in the club and the staff were absolutely fantastic, and they made me feel at home, and I have a lot to thank them for. But then they gave me the opportunity to move on, and obviously I went to Southampton and had a couple of years there. Yeah. And then I came home, and then that's when I really think my career kick-started, when Bruce Rioch got hold of me and I came to Bolton, and it's probably the best decision in football I've ever had to make. The hardest decision, because I was at Southampton, who then a First Division stroke Premiership club.
Nice part of the country as well to live, isn't it?
Yeah, it was beautiful, but when you're not playing or things are not right, all I wanted to do was play football. Do you know, it didn't matter where it was, I just wanted to play football. And when Bruce Rioch gave me that opportunity to come back and come up on loan and play, it was a tough decision. So I really wanted to make a go of it at Southampton, but it is the best decision I ever made, because I've had affiliation now with Bolton Wanderers for over 28 years.
Yeah.
And it's been my life, and I've loved every single minute of it.
It didn't take him long to sign you, because if I remember correctly, he only played 8 games and thought, we'll have a bit of him, like.
Yeah. But you know what? I think it was Bruce's work ethic. He was a disciplinarian, and I like that. And I've always been a disciplinarian myself, and I've always been self-disciplined. And Bruce wanted things doing correctly. And when everybody bought into what Bruce was trying to do at that football club, it brought success. It was damn hard work. And yeah, he trained as hard and he worked as hard. But on the flip side of it, we got to cup finals, we got championship medals. We gave great entertainment to the supporters. And it wasn't just about the players. It was about the staff at the club. It was about the club. It was about the town. And it was about the people who were involved in that football club. And that's when our family grew as Bolton Wanderers.
Do you know, when we had Rioch, I never seen one of his players who weren't 100%. And what I mean by that is they just give their all. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. It's very rare in today's game. It's just a different mentality. I don't know your thoughts on that.
No, I totally agree with you. And do you know what? None of the squad who played for Bruce, we never played well every week because it was impossible to do. You hit your highs, you hit your lows. But one thing that got you through was the work ethic. And I think that's where the Bolton Wanderers supporters are so forgiving, because if you don't play well and don't work hard, you can't accept that. And personally, and as players' pride, you can't accept that. You can accept playing poorly but working 100%. And throughout all the games where we maybe 1-0 down or 2-1 down with a few minutes to go, and we used to grind results out, it wasn't always because we played fantastic football. It's because we had that determination and that grit to think, come on, hey, we've got to put a shift in here. And over a period of time, the work ethic that was instilled into us eventually got us the success we needed. And then everybody was happy if you played well, you scored, or you created an opportunity, or you defended well and worked hard, everybody was happy. And that was the basis of our success at the football club.
Yeah, and as I say, it come across to us. We did care if we get beat, but we don't mind getting beat when you can't give any more. You know what I mean?
We got that team.
And what about the other four there? I've got them up the badges: Wigan, Blackpool, Carlisle, and Morecambe. Happy memories there.
Well, yeah. I mean, I was at Wigan Athletic for 3 years. Obviously, once I'd left Bolton Wanderers, I didn't want to leave Bolton Wanderers, but at the time, the chairman, I think Colin Todd had taken over as a manager, and he's obviously trying to build an infrastructure of a new squad, and it was time for me to go. So I was reluctant to go to Wigan, but listen, that's football and an experience. I ended up playing 3 years there. We had a little bit of success, so I did enjoy it. And within that period at Wigan, I had a long spell at Blackpool for a couple of months. To play football, I do enjoy it. And coming to the latter stages of my career, I had a little spell at Carlisle and then to Morecambe. But I was always forward thinking, and I always wanted to go on to the coaching side of it. And just going back to Bruce, when I first signed for the football club, the first day I was in the dressing room, he walked in and he went to me, "What are you going to do when you finish being a footballer?" I've not even thought about it, Gaffer. "Do your coaching badges," he said. And from that day forward, I started going into the coaching side of it, working in the centre of excellence as it was then at Bolton, and progressing through and doing all my coaching badges and getting all my experiences as a player. So when it came to the end of it, I was obviously fully qualified. And then when I went to Morecambe and a little bit of Carlisle, that was maybe a bit of a stopgap before I then eventually got an opportunity to go back to Wigan as the U-team coach under Paul Jewell. And I had an opportunity to get a 3-year or a 2-year contract, I think it was, at Rochdale when Steve Parkin was the manager. And I actually turned that down to go back into the coaching side of it with Wigan Athletic because of the longevity that I wanted to see, rather than a short-term 2-year contract and maybe not get that coaching opportunity. So that's why I did that.
Well, you did a fantastic job at Bolton with young'uns and all that. Anyway, that's your previous club sorted. I've knocked together a compilation for you from when you were at Bury. I have a lot of friends who are our Worbury fans, and one of them very kindly sent me this, and it's good anyway. Here we go.
Fantastic.
Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts some days, but everything will be alright. Go raise a glass and say, here's to-
54 minutes, the equalising goal for Bury, David Lee. Long ball to Lee, what a fine ball to Lee. Lee, and Lee for Bury, 2-1 up. What fantastic control. Beautiful through ball from Phil.
I thought the throwing should have been the other way. This is Feely. Hoyland. Lee, it's inside. And Leon with a chance, this could be number two. David Lee, maybe. Bury 2, Wrexham 0. Hoyland, forward by Patterson. Lee will chase. Lee wins possession, and this is a good chance for Bury. He's round him, and there it is. 3-2, David Lee. Given away to Robinson. Lee. Still David Lee. Still David Lee to go around the outside of May, looking for the goal. 6-0! It's Lee to shoot.
Tidies up and then messes it up, and it comes to Lee. Lee inside the box. This is good play from David Lee. It's a great shot. That's a goal for Bury.
Yeah. Liam Robinson, who touched finds David Lee, can use his pace. And that's got the feeding of Lynch. There's two joined him now in the penalty area. If Lee can get the cross, he might have a shot himself. What a great goal. Lee with this chance to put Bury level. And he's done it. And Lee. Ball's clear to McGinley, and a run clear for David Lee, and a chance of his first ever league hat-trick, David Lee, and he's done it, David Lee scores his first hat-trick. Lee, an ambitious ball, and it was perfectly executed. Lee cuts inside, it's the first time he's got away, gets the shot in, he's done it, it's footed, he curled that ball inside the... Lee shot, and it's in.
Wow.
Wow. So
need to practice my celebration.
Tell you what, I was just listening to some of them games, some of them names there, Parkinson, Patterson, yeah. McGinley. Yeah. And it's strange how you all follow up what they're about.
The first one you showed was the Swansea when we won at the Bexfield 1-0. That was Sammy McElroy who passed me that ball. He was a legend.
Wow!
Oh, yeah,
fantastic.
And you know the Cambridge game, the hat trick. I've still got that ball. I've got it in my cabinet here.
Have you?
Right. Brilliant.
Yeah. I don't know whether you can. Let me just see if you can see it. I don't know whether you can.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Got it. Yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah. Well, all the autographs have unfortunately faded away after all them years.
Well, what else have you got in there?
I'm surprised a certain person's not asked you for cut half of it because he made the third goal.
Super John?
Yeah.
I'm sure he'll mention it if he's watching this.
Oh, he's what? I know one person who is watching it. He absolutely loves the bones off you. And he does hell of a lot for our club and community and town. And that, as I say, Kelsey, he helps you with your Darien House project, doesn't he?
Yeah, he's brilliant. He really is, yeah. He's a great lad. And you know what? Kels and McGinn are fantastic lads. And we're like brothers. We look after each other. We help each other out. We can ask each other questions, tell each other things, and you know what? It's a great camaraderie we have between us.
Well, they say exactly the same. In fact, Tony were telling me that his dad were really struggling last week for a fridge. You got a new business now, aren't you? Doing white goods, and you were straight down and sorting them out with a fridge. Is that right?
Yeah, well, yeah. He's Kells's mum passed away a few months ago, obviously, and his dad's been having a bit of a tough time. And I think everything in the house that they had was sentimental, and the cooker that Kells's mum used to cook on was obviously part of the furniture at that house. And it's in better days, and Kells's brother Tommy said, we need a new one. So he asked me if I could get him a new oven for them. So yeah, I was straight down to the supplier, got him one, went, took it over and fitted it for him. And do you know what? Kells's dad, he had a few tears in his eyes because, one, obviously for helping him out, but I think it was a bit of a sentimental value when we was taking that old one out and putting the new one in for him. So, but yeah, and that's what you do for your mates. You help each other out, don't you?
Of course it is. Of course it is. I'm not just saying it because I'm on here, but I love Tony Kelly and his family, his sister and his dad, and me and always have a bit of banter, and he's one of the nicest, sweetest blokes you'll ever meet, you know what I mean? And as you just said, he's been through absolute hell, and it's not seeing Tony for 3 months, but it's like end of tunnel now.
Listen, we've got to be positive and look forward, haven't we? There's no use being pessimistic now, because pessimism, it drags you down. We've got to be positive, and there is light at the end of that tunnel, and we're all going to come through it in a safer place and be all better for it.
Well, there you go. So there you go, people. If you want any white goods and you want it delivered and fitted by a legend,
again, to being forward thinking, obviously I knew my time was going to be up at the football club, and once you leave a football club, it's very, very difficult to get in anywhere else. I'm very proactive. I always want to be doing things and be active. I don't like just sitting on my backside. And it's just over 12 months ago now, I thought, you know what, I'm going to have to do something, and I want a break from football. I want to do something totally different. I did all the spade work. I visited all the sites. I did the tutorials, and I really looked into the white goods side of it. And do you know what? I've set myself up a little business, and I collect them, I deliver them, I fit them, I take the old ones away for people, washers, dishwashers, fridge freezers, ovens, anything. And it's really took off, and it's kept me busy, and I love every minute of it because I'm out meeting people every day.
Superb. Well, there you go, people. Mr. Lee delivering your cooker. What more can you ask for?
If anybody sponsors my department, Al. sponsorships, so it's my department.
Right.
Listen, dear, that guy there has just spoke Twiggy. He's ruthless. Don't get too friendly with him. I'm not saying anymore, but he's ruthless. Right, so let's get on to the... What most of the lads want to know about the Bolton Wanderers. So I did the move from Southampton to come out. Obviously, it was Bruce, weren't it?
Yeah. Once I'd gone down to Southampton, I obviously moved from Bury to Southampton, played, I think, 24 games. And then I realised on the 25th game, the football club then, or Bury, or Southampton, had to pay Bury an extra, I think it was an extra £50,000 as part of the transfer fee. And at the time, £50,000 in football terms was a hell of a lot of money. And I played 24 games, and it was at the time when Ian Branfoot, as the manager, was having a bit of a bad time. And I'd gone in the team to replace Matthew Letizia, which is a hell of an ask. And the Saints fans really wanted Matthew in the team, obviously, because he was a fantastic, talented footballer. And then the Southampton had a decision to make whether to pay to play me in one more game, which made 25 games, and then they'd have to pay £50,000 more, or leave me out, put Mark Letizia back in the team. So that gave me a little run in the reserve team. And I must have been in the reserves for maybe 3 or 4 games. And obviously Bruce had realised that I wasn't playing first team football down at Southampton. And I was playing against QPR at our training ground called Roadsea in Southampton. And I played in the game. I think we won the game 1-0. And I scored, I think it was a screamer from a lucky 25 yarder with my left foot that flew in the top corner. And we finished the game. The morning after, I was at the training ground again at Roadsea. We were training. And then someone said, oh, David, you need to come in. There's a phone call for you at the training ground. And there it was. It was Bolton Wanderers asking me if I'd come up on loan. So I thought, well, do you know what? I'm not playing here at Southampton. Someone wants to take me and play me or give me the opportunity to play first team football. And that's how it came about. Initially, it was a month loan, and then it went to two or three. And then within the first, like you said earlier in the conversation, after eight games, Bruce said that they wanted to buy me. And I was happy to come back because the infrastructure of the club, the structure that Bruce had put in place, the people within the club, the town, the people, it was a no-brainer for me. And that's how I thought. I was desperate to sign. And then Bruce got something sorted out with Southampton. And then I put pen to paper. And it, like I say, it was the best decision, the best signature I ever did.
Well, thank God you did.
So am I. I can't believe it. I loved it.
I got a few pictures there in various shirts, and I'm going to ask you about that shirt.
God, let me have a look at that one. Yeah, is that a Premier League shirt? That one.
Yeah, I don't know. The bloke who put on about John.
Super John. Yeah. Gosh. Yeah, I've still got my, you know, the one we played in at Anfield, the number four shirt. I've still got that.
Have you?
Yeah, and I've also got the cup final shirt against Liverpool, and obviously Stig Bjornby's as well. We swapped on the day, so I've kept two or three of the memorable shirts. Yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah, but some great pictures. It brings back some happy times. It really does. Fantastic.
Yeah, oh, look at your mate at end there. I think he's out of breath.
Yeah. But every time I see that picture, that photograph there, I get the story from Kells. What about my disallowed free kick? Because his first one was a genuinely good free kick and it should have stood.
Yeah.
If you remember it on the night.
Yeah, I remember his celebration when he was going off, when he went live.
Oh, yeah. I can believe it, yeah. But no, great. I mean, great memories, aren't they? Well, I've still got that on my wall behind us, yeah.
That is the most famous picture, apart from lifting the FA Cup where Loftus has sat on the team. Wow. That is the most famous Bolton Wanderers picture ever.
Yeah. It's brilliant because I know everybody asks about it. And what we did for Bolton Hospice just before Christmas, trying to think how long ago it was now, but we, myself, John and Andy, my partner, Joe, she actually drew that in pencil, and then we sold them off and all the proceeds went to Bolton Hospice, Sam. I think we made them a couple of grand in the end with selling them off, so it was fantastic. And John, Andy and myself all signed those, and then the money went to Bolton Hospice, so the history of it is fantastic, but it's great to know all 20-odd years later, it's still raising funds for Bolton Hospice, which is a great cause.
Yeah, I've got a few of Joe's drawings coming up later on because she actually did a commission for us, which we're going to auction at our next event. But right. That picture you're on about the Matt from White Walls,
just give us
that. To auction off at the remembrance event, we've actually got that all framed up with the placking and everything.
Fantastic, yeah.
That's going to be auctioned off as well, that Joe did. So that should go quite a few quid because it's got to be the most iconic picture, I think, from the modern era, to be honest.
Yeah, and everybody remembers it, everybody talks about it. And do you know what? It actually put Bolton Wanderers back on the map a little bit, didn't it? It's fantastic. What a night for the football club that was, and the supporters. Something we always talk about and never forget. It's a great memory. It really is.
Superb. Right. Well, I think we'll get on to Bolton Wanderers then and see what you think about some of these when I can find it.
Okay.
Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts some days. But I'm out. Morris. Lee cutting inside and whips it in past Walsh's left hand. And Bolton Wanderers have the goal. And it's
is it playing that?
No.
David Lee. Come on.
No.
Come on, you white men.
Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts some days.
Taken by David Lee.
Yeah, he's getting
in. Get it up here.
Oh, I'm getting in there.
The commentary's better than the action.
Oh.
Remember that.
Yeah.
Where was that at, Ken?
Reading that. Reading that.
Sign that, mum.
Look at this with a ball. Pick a pass, Kelly. Watch this.
Oh, it's brilliant.
Look at that.
What a ball.
Sixpence.
Well, did you knock him out at work, isn't it, Rod?
Yeah. Brilliant.
Yeah. How did that go in?
Fantastic. Get in there. Fantastic.
Paddy.
Everybody hurts sometimes. Everybody hurts some days. But everything will be alright. Go raise a glass and say,
there we go. That's we managed to get it on. But yeah, some of them goals are memories. Davey, you brought us some fantastic memories there. And we really would like to thank you for that. And then you went into coaching, as you say, and eventually you ended up at Bolton and you did an absolute, if I may say so, you did an absolutely fantastic job with young'uns.
Yeah, do you know, I think not just from a coaching perspective, but actually instilling some work ethic and some life skills into the young lads. I mean, they're all 16, 17, 18, up to the age of maybe 20, 21 years of age. There's still a lot of learning to do. And from the coaching perspective, you can coach them all day and you can do tactical and technical work with them. But it's that mentoring that I found was the best way of bringing players on, because my life experiences, not just in football, but in life as a grown, mature man, being able to give those experiences to those young players didn't half help them. It helped them to grow up. It helped them to mature in their own families, how to conduct themselves, and have a work ethic and a bit of dignity about what they did, and not to let themselves down, and have a bit of pride and passion about what they were doing. And I mean, myself and Kells, we had some fantastic success with those under 23 players, and it's so rewarding to see them come to fruition at under 23's level and then play first team football. And the good thing now is that still the young lads, or I still call them young lads, they're a hell of a lot younger than me, they still speak to me, they still say, oh, I remember when we did that, when we do that, and you've instilled something into them that'll be with them for the rest of their lives. And it's great to be able to be rewarded with seeing them on the pitch and making successful careers for themselves. It's brilliant. Really enjoyed every minute of the coaching side.
Well, you did a fabulous job, and I don't know about the other lads, but I'm one of these. Don't fix it. Don't. It doesn't need fixing if it's not broke, and it wasn't broke.
No.
Well, that's my opinion. Yeah.
But that's football, isn't it? And people have differences of opinions. And if I was still at the football club now, I'd still be doing 100% and trying to create an opportunity for a young player to come through. So whether it ever happens again, I don't know. But I always give 100% to the football club and those youngsters. And I was always totally 100% professional with them. And I think the conduct that those players have shown have proved what myself and Tony instilled into them.
You just took your playing. You just took your playing career and your mentality when you were playing into coaching.
Yeah. Do you know what? I don't think there's any magic formula. It's how you treat people and how you respect those people and gain the respect of the people you're working with. If they can buy into that and they can give you the respect and you show them the respect they deserve, I think you've got a working formula. And yeah, there are times when you've got to come down hard on them. And that's where Tony and myself were good, because it was always good cop, bad cop. And believe it or not, I was the bad cop, because I was the one who was instilling all the discipline. And then you've got Kells with his experience, then coming to build them up again and knocking them down and building them up again. And instilling that into the players, that it's great being a footballer, but I tell you what, it's damn hard work to get where you want to be. And a lot of those under 23 players took that on board and have made successful careers for themselves, and it's great to see, and a reward for the football club or other football clubs that they've moved on to.
Well, as I said, thanks for everything you've done for the club, mate. You'll always be part of our group, as we call the old school.
Anything we do,
events, we have days, you'll always be invited, mate. And if you can't,
I appreciate that. Just finally, because of what the football club gave to me in my life, it's not all about take. You've got to give a bit back. And that was my thank you to the football club for all the hard work that they put into me and shown me and give me that opportunity, and I always wanted to put that back into the football club, and hopefully it's proved that if you do give something back, people get the rewards for it, and those young lads and the football club have had the rewards and will continue to do so.
We'll get onto that in this video, and believe me, if everybody put back what you put back, mate, the world would be a better place. Anyway, we've got a few questions for you now. We'll start with this one. This is one of your mates. Here we go.
Hi, Dids. Hope you're well. And on behalf of Bolton Wanderers Remembrance Group and ex-players alike, we'd love to say a big, big thanks for all the effort that you put in, both as a player and as a coach of the club. And hopefully it'll be a fitting tribute where the club will have you back one day to recognise you on the pitch at half-time, maybe. Anyway, for tonight's stream, your question is, during your time at Bolton Wanderers as a coach, can you name the most outstanding talent you ever coached? Have a good night, Dids. Cheers, mate.
The most outstanding... I missed half it, but it was a question, the most outstanding talent I'd coached.
First of all, he said thanks for everything you've done for Bolton and all your contributions and that you should get at some point when all the crowds are back in, you should get announced onto a pitch so all the fans can pay their respects to you as well.
Oh, really? Oh, that's nice.
And then he went on to say, the question for you is, who is the most outstanding player you've ever coached?
Right. Well, if we go back to the times when, do you remember a young boy called George Iliev at the football club or not?
No.
No, he was a foreign lad, and he, for me, was a talent where he could head it, he could kick it, he was athletic, he could run, he could dribble, he could score goals. And it was an absolute joy to work with. And once we, myself and Kelzer, took him to a level, and then he went to first team level, it was taken away from him because he didn't get the individual coaching that he needed on a regular basis, because he was slipped into mainstream first team. And then sometimes if the first team are playing week in, week out, it's literally about playing, recover, playing, recover. So he missed an integral part of his development. But George Iliev, for me, was probably one of the outstanding youngsters who could have been on to be a top professional player in the Premier League, I believe. And I know, speaking with Tony Kelly, probably reiterate that. He had everything, but unfortunately, it was mismanaged once he'd gone past our under-18s, as it was then, he was an absolute joy to work with. He was a class lad, and unfortunately, he fell out of the game when he really needed an arm around him. And the same happened with a lad called Tom Walker, who was at the football club a couple of games. And then he got into Neil Lennon's first team squad. And rather than coming back in the afternoons with myself and doing some extra coaching, he was slipped into that mainstream first team group, who trained once or twice a week maximum, but played games in between. And he was in that group, so he was missing out. Even though he might be getting 15, 20 minutes on the first team pitch, he still needed that individual work put into him in the afternoons. And he lost maybe 18 months, 2 years of his career because he wasn't getting that intense training that he needed and the fundamentals to enable him to bridge that gap when he played regular first team football. But fortunately now, even though he's missed that 18 months, he's back. He went to Salford, and then he went to, I think he was at Fylde, and I think he went over to Harrogate, and he's playing first team football at Harrogate. So he has made it three, but yeah, there's too many players. Once they break away from their 18s and the 23s football and they're into first team mainstream, it's very rarely that you'll get a young player who will play first team week in, week out, but they actually go into the mainstream training of a first team group who don't train a lot because of the games. And it's then you need a good manager at the helm of a football club to say, hey, you might be with the first team, but you still need the basics and more fundamentals put into it. Get back to my group, do some afternoon sessions, and then keep dipping them in and dipping them out again. And that's where I think a lot of young footballers miss out, because they're straight into the first team. They get on the coach with the first team. They travel away on a Friday, play on the Saturday, and then they're off and they come back in on the Monday and they're preparing for a game for the Tuesday. So they're missing the basic training that they need. So there's been some fantastic talents, and there could have been one or two more giving that opportunity for us to develop a little bit longer. You'd have probably seen some more talent come through as well. But I think George Iliev and Tom Walker, Zach Clough was a perfect example of it. He used to come back when he was the first team, come back and we'd do sessions with him. Connor Hall was another one. We used to bring him back and do extra training sessions, just simple passing drills and finishing drills. And even though they're in the first team group, they were getting that extra little bit that they needed, and then it stands them in good stead further down the line.
Yeah. Right, one of our admins, good lad, lifetime wanderer. Unfortunately, he works on a Sunday night, but he sent a little question for you as well.
Okay.
Hi. My question is, after the Liverpool game and your performance, did you get any offers off big teams? Okay, thanks.
That's a good question. Do you know what? If we did as a football club, Bruce kept it very quiet and didn't tell anybody. and you know what? I'm so glad nothing ever materialised from it. But today, we got a lot of publicity, but I didn't know I didn't have any inclination of any other football club wanting to come in for me. But you know what? When you're in a football club and you're in a successful team and you're playing well and you have a group of players, why do you want to move anyway? And I think it'd have been a very, very difficult decision if somebody had come in and said, right, we're going to take you away, because I loved it playing at Bolton Wanderers, every minute of it. And when you get something that you enjoy, you never want it to end. So I was never told about anybody.
I think it were more than a team that, David. I think it were a family.
It was. Yeah. And I always talk about Bruce Rio, and I don't like calling him Bruce because I've got that much respect for him. I always call him the gaffer. Even if I see him today, I still call him the gaffer. But he was fantastic at bonding everybody within that football club. And it didn't matter what job you did, whether you was car park attendant, or you were making the tea at half time, or you were doing the kit. You were part of that football club, and Bruce made everybody part of that. And no one was better than anybody else. We were all on an even keel, and everybody respected each other. And that's why I think we got the success and like you said, the family, the bond that we had.
Right. We had a car park attendant.
Hey, it was sometimes other players going out there.
And to be fair, David, you was already at a big club.
Exactly, yeah. That's a good answer. I like that one.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, I've had this little fella from Four Lane Ends mirroring me, and my phone's never stopped pinging today.
Right.
And apparently he likes ticking pie chips and peas every day. When we were playing football, have you got a guess?
A player?
Yeah. And the coach. He weren't a bad coach either.
Kells loved his pies.
Ah, well, here we go.
Even Dizzy, just like to wish you all the best
on
your new venture and whatever you're doing. And as I say, a massive thank you for everything you've done for me in the past. The memories you've got, mate, they'll never be able to take away. So I just have to say, thank you very much and good luck. All the best, mate.
There you go. What a lovely...
Top man.
Right, we're going to get into some questions of people who's on YouTube and Facebook at the moment. But first, we'll let the admins ask a question apiece. We'll go to Johnny Vegas first, who's got a fixation with ceiling tonight on this stream. So there you go, Darren. Take it away.
Good evening, David. You okay?
I am. Yeah, really nice to speak to you.
One of the questions I always ask all the ex-players is, especially with you being a super skillful winger, who was the hardest player or defender that used to kick chunks out of you week on week?
Well, I remember playing against Stuart Pearce a number of times, and I remember playing against him for Southampton against Forest. And even before he went out, he'd be in the corridor with his huge tree trunk legs all smooth, all like oiled up, just in his underpants, thinking, you know, I'm a big, strong man. I'm going to be really aggressive against you. But I love the challenge of that, of playing against big, physical, strong players, because I think wingers sometimes get that reputation where if you get kicked, they'll disappear. But I used to enjoy the challenge of people kicking chunks out of me, because it made me feel better, because I thought, well, they're obviously feared of me because I've got a bit of pace. It might exploit them a little bit. So Stuart Pearce used to always try and kick lumps out of me. But I think the best player I've probably played against would probably be Nigel Winterburn, because he wasn't the most physical, but he was quick and he was an intelligent player. As a winger, you've got to either use your skill and technique to beat a defender, or you can use your raw pace. Now, if you've got a bit of both, then you're going to have a good time against your fullback. But Nigel, he was quick, he was aggressive, he read the game well. So whatever way, if I tried to beat him with pace, often he'd keep up with you. And then if you went into a 1v1 technical situation with him, he could probably master you and realise what you're going to do, so he could counteract it. Yes, I had Joey against him, but he also had Joey against me, but he was very, very difficult to play against because most of the fullbacks when I played were either big, physical, strong players who just wanted to nail you straight away. And as soon as you've got that turn of pace and you pass them, they're gone. You left them for dead. But the more modern player, like Nigel, was ahead of his time, and obviously he saw his success with them, with Arsenal. He had the ability to keep up with you fitness-wise as well. So I'd say from a physical point of view, it's got to be Stuart Pearce. But from a technical and a tactical point of view, I think it's got to be Nigel Winterburn.
Superb. Cheers, David. Thanks, pal.
No, thank you. Good question. Thank you.
Oh, good question, Daz.
quiz
well done, Paul.
Cheers.
Yeah, just one I've got, David. Do you know when the under-23s came in, you know, when we were going through a bad time at the club, yeah, and they did us proud in all them games that they played, did you have kind of any influx on them? But I know obviously Phil Parkinson, he was on the touchline, he kind of team sort of thing, but it was a totally different style of play, because I used to go to the under-23s and watch them, obviously your team.
Yeah.
They did us proud and everything. Did you have any influx on them, or what was the...
The only input I had was obviously what I'd instilled into those players over the latter years that they were with me. And once you put those fundamentals into players, then you're hoping that if they take it on board, they can then use those skills they've learned onto the first team experience. I think a lot of it goes down to the players having the ability in the first place to go out there and do it. But I think those first few games of those young players went in and did so well was because of the adrenaline. And I think a great massive part of it was the naivety of actually going to play and having that enthusiasm and not worrying about the opposition. I think when you get a little bit older, more mature as a player, and you realise it's your job as well as a career, and if you don't be successful, you don't pay the bills. As a young lad, you don't even think about that. You just go out and play as if you're playing with your mates on the school football pitch or in the yard with your mates. And I think those players that went in and did that played on adrenaline, naivety, and then obviously... Once he started getting hired in 4 and 5 at Tranmere and things like that, that was then the time it was right to bring him out and get the old school back in and fill it with the more experienced players. But yeah, it was all I said, like I said, to answer your question simply, was I had an input into those players. But once you get on the football pitch, it's down to those lads. And obviously, Phil Parkinson was orchestrating it from the sidelines.
Yeah, but the 0-0 draw, obviously against Coventry, you know, and all those fans stayed back at the end, and they got a standing ovation, them players, you know. And Coventry had 3 goals disallowed that day as well.
You know,
but what a moment for them. But what a moment for them players, because they all got a standing ovation at the end of it. It was like a cup final.
You know what? That will go down in history for those, and they'll never, ever forget that experience that they've been given. And because of unforeseen circumstances, that opportunity was there. And the great thing was, they took that opportunity. They didn't melt and fade away. They stood up as immature young 16, 17-year-olds and a few 20-year-olds and did themselves proud. It was a proud moment for them, the families, the supporters, and the football club in general.
Yeah, it did us proud. Thanks, David. Yeah.
Thank you.
Well done to you. Yeah, just a little addition to that. They actually beat the team that got promoted as well. I think a lot of people they didn't beat it when they were 0-0, weren't it? But they actually got promoted, Coventry, didn't they?
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, I thought.
You know what? It was so good that it was actually at the stadium rather than be away, and everybody could sample it and get an experience of it, rather than a few hundred supporters who would have been allowed to go to Coventry. Obviously, the ground was full, and it was a great experience for them. And
it was.
I didn't sleep that night anyway after the game.
Right, this is one of our most popular sections. We're going over to social media, so we'll hand over to Hagee. just play a little bit of an intro and then we'll get straight into it.
Hey, David.
Hi, are you okay?
All right, mate, yeah. We'll have a word with Twiggy after as well. He needs to stick to one question, not a bloody documentary.
Okay, mate, yeah. Is time running out?
Oh, no, absolutely not. No, if Twiggy gets carried away, it goes from one question to a full, documentary on it. I've got loads of questions here, mate. Questions
Brilliant.
And comments all off a live stream, what's going on now.
Okay.
One of the best ones I've seen here is Jeff Sherples have commented that Matt Letizia actually said you were the best crosser of a ball he has ever played with. What a statement from like someone like Matt Letizia.
Wow, I've never heard that before, but listen, well, to receive fantastic. That from Matt Letizia is a great honour.
Absolutely.
I am touched by that, to be honest, yeah.
Oh, fantastic, mate. Just another few things here. You've got people online at the moment. You've got Mark Kame, Jeff Chandler, Andy Bowling, all watching yeah. live. They all say hiya to you. Obviously,
hiya,
you
lads.
Can't see the comments coming through.
Brilliant.
David Southern, one of our admins, can't make it tonight, but he's another one who says hi.
Hi, David.
I'll just start off with my question. I know you've got other interests outside of football, obviously golf in that, but who in the... Obviously, your fridge freezers and your washers and your dryers now as well. But,
yeah.
But who is the best sports person? Best sportsman in any line of sport? Who would you like to have met in your lifetime? Any sport?
I love my golf. I really do. I love my football. I love my other sports. Yeah. Who would I like to meet? Do you know, I think if anybody, and I'm not really a tennis player, but I think Roger Federer.
Right.
Excellent. Because the way he conducts himself, the way he is so professional, the way he plays the game, the way he just keeps himself fit and healthy and strong and keeps winning, and the mentality that he's had over all those years, I'd love to know his secret formula.
Great. Great. That's just my question because I'm a nosy sod, so I just like knowing other people's things. Right. I've got Mal from Mali. They've done it again on me. I've got a Malteser. Wants to know Malteser. Yeah, it's a proper question, dude. Who was the best player and manager you ever played for? The best player you played with. And the best manager you played for.
Right. Well, if you go for the best player I ever played with, I couldn't differentiate between a couple, actually. Obviously, the one you spoke about, Matt Letizia.
Yep.
Because he was an absolute genius with the football. Alan Shearer, because he was a goal scorer. But close to home, I look at Kells, the way he could pass the ball. He was fantastic. You look at Super John, how he could score goals from nothing. And then the other midfield player was Richard Sneakers, who I thought was an absolute diamond.
Oh, yeah.
Player.
Yeah, Sneakers, yeah.
So individually, I couldn't really specify to one because each player that you play with gives you something to the game. Sneaks, he was technically very good, could pass the ball. Kells could put a ball where you wanted it to go. Alan Shearer would score goals wherever you put one. Letizia could do anything with the ball and score goals. And Super John, obviously, but always put the ball in the back of the net. And those are the people that you relied on for part of my job as well. Because if I was crossing the ball, I knew Super John would put it in the back of the net. I had to receive the ball. Sneaky could pass it to me. So could Tony Kelly. So each player has an ingredient that makes you a better player. So those four or five I spoke about, they're the ones who you think, God, fantastic players, because they're the ones you have a connection with. And then you've got your stalwarts like Phil Brown at fullback who just say, right, there's the ball. Go and get at him.
Go do it. Go do your job. Yeah. Right, I'll move on from that one. Obviously, I was set up with that one with the Maltese a bit. We had T. Wicks on last week. So I've got another comment here from one of your playing mates, from John McGinley. David Lee, he's made a statement. The man who single-handedly destroyed Liverpool in the best live performance I've ever seen from a player. He was totally unplayable that night and had the game of his life. That's from Super John.
Oh. Nice word from him, honestly. But do you know what? It's fantastic for someone to say that about me. And yeah, I did have a good game that night, but
yeah.
So did the 10 other players, and so did the 8,000 supporters who were there that night. And for me, I don't like the individuality where it's all about me, because it was all about the football club that night. And I was a small integral part of that, but it's great for John to say that, and I really appreciate
Absolutely.
It.
Fantastic. Question here from Larry B. Who gave you the biggest bribe to play on their team in the Legends game? Kells or Super John?
I was torn between the two of them. I really was. And they set me up. I did it. Emma, who used to work at the football club in the commercial side of it, she said, David, would you come upstairs to the media room? I'd like to do an interview with you. So I said, yeah, no problem whatsoever. And I never refuse anybody. If you want me to do anything, I'll do it for them. She said, if you come up to the media room at a certain time, we'll put the camera on and we'll do it. And we'll go through the interview. So I sat down. If you've ever been into the press room at the football club, you've got all your advertising at the back of it. And I'm sat on the table like that, doing the interview. And Emma's going through the questions. And then she diverts from the questions of who's your favourite player, blah, 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 who's done that, to what do you think of Tony Kelly? What do you think of John McGinley? Do you think Kells has put a bit of weight on? Do you think he'll be fit to play in the game? Super John can't get around the pitch like he used to do. And they were waiting for me to criticise it. And I don't do that to people, you know what I mean? And I was going all around the houses not to criticise either of them.
Yeah.
And then, next minute, I turn round behind me and they both stood behind me.
Right.
Yeah. She sticks me up. And they were wanting me to weigh one to the other. Do I play for John or do I play for Kells? Obviously that decision was made and I played and I couldn't keep them both happy. And I think John made the final decision in the end. But do you know what a fantastic job those two did to raise the profile of that and raise so much money. And what a fantastic day it was. It was brilliant.
Fantastic. Thanks. You're being set up again here now, right? I've got a DM. Who is the best golfer? You or Super Job?
At the moment, neither of us, because we can't play.
Right. And the other bit of the question, does Super John cheat? Now, don't forget your life. Your life,
no. No. Listen, no, absolutely. When we go back to the days of playing football and being honest with each other and doing the best we can, I would never cheat at golf for John. And I know for a fact John would never cheat with me. Over a season of golf, John has got the edge on me.
All right. Oh.
I do beat him and I have beaten him. But every time we play, it's a hell of a game. And I would say John has got the edge on me.
Right. Handicaps, yours, your handicap?
Yeah, when I play with John, it's 16 and John's round about the 14, 15 mark. So there's not a lot between us. But John has just got that. At Bolton, the last four holes, Super John comes alive on him. And he's brilliant on the last four holes at Bolton Golf Club.
Excellent.
And you can be winning up to those last four holes, and that's when he turns the screw and the pressure's on. But it's that competitiveness in us, and when you get beat by the better person. So whoever wins, it's a shake hands.
Yeah, absolutely. Right, I'm being set up again here. I've got another one here from Steve Runche. Who's the toughest defender you've ever played against? I think we can answer that. I think you said about Stuart Pearce, haven't you?
Stuart Pearce, yeah. And from a tactical and technical point of view, it's got to be Nigel Winterburn, yeah.
Absolutely. They're really setting me up here on C Runchy. They must think I'm stupid.
We can handle it and answer them.
Oh, absolutely. I've got one here from Scooby from the Wonders Way Forum. Who was the biggest character and prankster in all your time at Bolton Wanderers?
I've already spoke about him on the golf course.
Ah, right.
Super John. He was... Yeah, good. He did have some... The thing about John was he was funny and he did some pranks on players, but he was only ever when he was injured and everybody used to go out training and he'd come back and John would either set you up, he'd either cut your socks, cut your laces, stuck your training shoes to the ground with super glue, made the bath cold or the showers cold for when you get in them. And yeah, he was a character. You always pray that John was not injured because otherwise you knew something was going to happen to your club. But the camaraderie there, you had Owen Coyle, you had Kells, you had Super John. And they used to bounce off each other, and it was good fun. It was a great dressing room to be in.
Excellent. Excellent. I've got one here from Stu from Wanderers Ways as well. Do you still have the passion for football, and do you intend to carry on in football?
Do you know what? If I'm really honest, for the last 2 years at the football club, I did lose my passion for it because my hands were tied. And no disrespect to Keith Hill and David Flitcroft when they came in, and they wanted to run it from top to bottom. So when I, that last season when, well, that season when Hilly and Flitcroft were there, they seemed to take over the 23s. They managed it. They picked the team. They wanted to come in at half-time. Listen, that's their, you've got to respect that. They wanted to do that. So, for that 12 months, I really didn't do much coaching whatsoever. There may have been an overspill of two or three players that needed looking after. But the majority of the time, I was literally out on a limb just watching them, because they amalgamated the 23 group and the first group and kept them together, which was that was their decision. They wanted to do that, so it was fine. So to answer his question, I started losing the passion and the love for it because I had not much involvement in it. And then obviously for the last 12 months with the lockdown and before I actually officially left the football club, I wasn't doing anything at the football club and I wasn't coaching and I was furloughed. So I think I've been in football since the age of 16.
Yeah.
I'm 53 now. I've had 36, nearly 37 years of non-stop football. And it took this break or the pandemic to make me take stock and think, do you know what? Life's not all about football, and maybe you do need a break from it. And I want to work. I love being out of working, and that's why I set my white goods business up, because I knew I needed time away from football. Yeah. Will I ever go back into it? It's a $1 million question. If an opportunity came along and they said, David, would you come and do this? I'd have to seriously think hard about it, because I've been out of the game now for a bit of time, and I'm not missing it because of the circumstances, and we haven't got that passion and drive for the football because there's no supporters and that, and I'm actually enjoying being away from it and not having the pressures of trying to produce players or looking over your shoulder, are you doing things right? And it was time to move on, and it was a right time to move on, and it has been a blessing for me because it's given me a new lease of life and an outlook on life, and I'm absolutely loving it. So it would be a fantastic, it'd be a question for somebody to ask me when I come back into football. At this moment in time, I couldn't say yes or no.
Right.
And that's being really honest.
Yeah. Right. I've got a question here from Sam Booth, which might, it's a bit of a nerve really as well. How gutted was you to miss the playoff final against Reading?
Yeah, I was gutted, yeah, because when you've worked all
absolutely,
season to
yeah.
get where you get to. But again, the camaraderie in the football club and the belief and the love that everybody have for each other.
Yeah.
I still played my part with getting them to the final, and then missing out on it. Yeah, circumstances being, it was a missed time challenge from Mark Venus, and I broke three metatarsals in my foot. And I knew from the moment I'd done it, because I was never one to lie down and think, oh God, I'm injured. I wanted to get up and carry on, but I knew as soon as that challenge had happened, I knew I was done for. And I ended up in the Beaumont Hospital, and then the surgeon said, yeah, you broke three metatarsals. And the first question I asked was, when's the final? Will I make it? And he's like, no chance. So I think the moment it happened, it wasn't, oh, I might make it. The decision was made for me. But the lads did fantastic on that day, and I was so proud of them. And to still be a part of it and go down with the team and be in the dressing room and be on the coach beforehand and the hotel and be part of it after. And like Bruce, the manager, you always said, it wasn't about one game. It was about the longevity of the season.
Getting that. Absolutely,
I was disappointed, but elated that the lads did so well. And Fabian knocking those two goals was a great memory.
Just a couple left now. I've got one from a Tony Gent, who remembers meeting you at Andy's party with Brother Graham. He said, what a great day, and tells you to take care.
Oh, thank you.
Tony really Gent.
Appreciate it.
Excellent. And finally, if you do fancy putting your boots back on, Jay Carter says there's a place at Moss Bank for you.
Is that right? Okay.
Excellent. Thanks,
I'll
David.
I'll try to find my boots.
Great stuff. Thanks, mate. Back to Alan in the studio.
You're welcome. Thank you.
That was brilliant. That was really, really interesting. Right, David, this is a section that me and Aggie like go, oh, it's ruthless. It's ruthless. But I'll let the main man tell you about it. Here we go. It would help if I played right one, really, wouldn't it?
Well, I'm the type of guy who will never settle down. Where pretty girls are, well, you know that I'm around. I kiss them and I love them, cause to me they're all the same. I hug them and I squeeze them, they don't even know my name. They call me the Wanderer.
Hey Dave.
Hello mate, you okay?
Yeah, not bad. Hey, this section's brilliant. Take the notice of them. Take the notice of them.
Who do I believe?
Well, after these questions, you'll make your decision. I've got a new word, ruthless. I've made
right,
it.
Okay.
But yeah, there's 10 questions here, so we'll see how we go. Right, question number one. Oh, just before I start, Al told me off for forgetting this again. You've got to ask an admin. If you get stuck on a question, you can ask one of the admins. You can ask one of the admins of for an answer. Right. You don't have to take their answer, but you've got two options of that.
Right.
Here we go. Right, question number one.
Have I got John McGinley, Tony Kelly's phone a friend or not?
No.
Oh, cheers.
Great answer. Sorry, mate. Right, here we go. Whose nickname is the Oysters?
Southern team.
I've got to give you 5 seconds on it.
Okay. Colchester.
The old spot on, Dave. Nice one.
I nearly said Torquay.
Just trying to think what I can't think of what their nickname is. Offhand. No. Right, question number two. Which team used to play at the old showground before moving to a new ground in 1988?
Grezza used to be manager there, didn't he? Scunthorpe?
Yeah, spot on.
Yeah.
I've been told in recent weeks that I'm kind of nodding and like that, so I can't do anything.
Right.
Right.
Graham Alexander was manager there for a while, wasn't
he? Yeah, Scunthorpe. Right, question number three. Name two players that have played for both Bolton and Southampton in the Premier League.
Kevin Davies.
Yeah, that's one of them.
Me?
No, I can't. I should have excluded you.
I know. he played in the Legends game. Simon Charlton.
Yeah, spot on, Dave. Spot on. 3 out of 3. The other two were Danny Guthrie and Rod Wallace.
Yeah. Which Wallace? So,
Rod Wallace.
Right, yeah. One of the three brothers, yeah.
But there's so 3 out of 3. Right, question number 4. We've got a video clip of what happens next.
Right.
So just have a look and then give us your answer.
Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts some days.
Was that? It looked like Middlesbrough and Everton. Right. I think I know this.
I'm going to put my poker face on. You can ask one of the admins if, mind you, they want.
No, I think that's a famous clip, that. It's something to do with either the corner flag or the lady linesman. I don't know whether one of the players pulls the flag out. I think that, I'm sure there's a lady linesman and one of the players knocks her over and she just gets up and picks the flag up and either points to the corner or free kick or whatever.
So what are you going for?
I think it's Everton, and the Everton player runs into her down the line, knocks her over, she knocks the flag down, and not the corner flag, a signal flag, and she picks it up, and I think she either points for an offside or a goal kick or something like that.
Let's have a look. That's a good, that's a, I don't know the final part. Everybody hurts sometimes. Yeah, you're spot on, Dave. Spot on with that. Yeah, I can't fault you on that. Spot on. Right, question number 5. How many goals did John McGinley score for Bolton? And you can have 10 either way on that.
God. I remember him getting his 100th goal. Did he get 100?
I can say you could ask an admin, but I think where you're going, you don't need them.
No. I remember John's 100th goal because I've seen a photograph of it. I don't think he scored anymore after that. I think it was time for him to move on.
What's your answer?
Do you know what? You know the saying, room 101. I'll go for 101.
101? Absolutely spot on 101 it is. Can't believe that.
I knew he didn't score many more after that.
It's my room, big deal. I've got a camera here somewhere looking at the answers. Right, spot on, Dave. Yeah. Right, question number 6. Which club did Bolton re-sign Jimmy Phillips from in 1993?
He went to music. He's a North East club. Did he go to Middlesbrough and then come back from? I think he went to Middlesbrough and then come back from Middlesbrough.
Is that your answer?
Yeah, because he went to Rangers as well. I think it's Middlesbrough.
Yeah, spot on again. 6 out of 6, Dave.
Oh, that's it. I'm done now.
Right, with question number 7. It's a video question, this, and it's off one of the admins, Eddie Gilroy. So have a look at this.
Yeah.
Hi, David. What club did we sign Sasa Cercik from in 1995?
Sasa.
God. I might need help on this one.
You can ask an admin if you want.
I'm guessing I'm wrong. Can I ask the admin or not?
No, you've got to ask an admin and you can choose their answer. You give the final answer.
All right, so they can give me an answer, but I don't have to use it.
Yeah, that's right. So
I've got one in my mind. Right, I'll speak to the admin.
Right, which one do you want? You've got Al.
Come on, Al's the first one you mentioned. Let's speak to Al. Let's wait for Al. Hello, Al.
Partizan Belgrade, Paul.
Yeah, I was going to say Partizan Belgrade, yeah. But I'm not sure whether it was...
Yeah, spot on, Dave. 7 out of 7. I'm sure my room's rigged here. Like, question number 8. Other than Bolton and Arsenal.
Just a sec. It don't like you getting them right, you know.
All right. Hey, Al, you got that one right, not me.
Yeah, but I want you to, but it's just a sticker get off everybody else.
All right.
Hey, some say my questions are too easy.
They are tough questions, then. I've been lucky on a couple.
Oh, yes, but right. Other than Bolton and Arsenal, name 2 other English clubs that Bruce Rioch has managed.
Well, we've already spoke about one, Middlesbrough.
Yeah, I thought when you mentioned it.
and then I tell you, I know 3 because he was at Wigan, because he asked me to come back on trial there.
Yeah.
And he also went with, he was down at, I'm trying to think who his assistant was, down London. He was at QPR. Yeah. And also, I know exactly where else he was as well, Bruce. He was at Norwich.
Yeah. Tell you what, I'm going to cover.
Did he start at Southend or Torquay? I think he started at Torquay.
Yeah. Tell you what, I'm gonna cover my answers up here. I'm sure I've got a camera rigged on them.
I'm definitely going to Middlesbrough, Millwall, and QPR. That's the other one, Millwall.
Yeah, well, yeah, you've got them all. But basically, you needed 2. So, yeah, Torquay, Middlesbrough, Millwall, Norwich, Wigan, and he was assistant at QPR.
Yeah.
8 out of 8. Impressed.
I remember playing for Wigan against Norwich.
Yeah.
Down at Carrow Road when he was a manager and John Benson was manager at Wigan.
Yeah, I was checking all that stats, yeah. Right. Question number 9. What nationality is ex-Bolton player and your former Carlisle teammate Ian Stevens?
Oh, I used to travel up to Carlisle with Ian Stevens.
Yeah, what's his nationality? Don't forget, you've got another avenue.
Now, just going back to the questions and answers before, we had a question about somebody called Maltese, and I didn't know whether that was his nickname, Maltese.
Yeah. Impressive, dude. 9 out of 9, that.
We used to pick Ian up on the way up to Carlisle. There was Julian Darby, Mark Winstanley, myself, and Ian Stevens in the car.
But when it came up, that thing that said Maltese, I thought, you know, it's...
We used to pick him up at Lancaster on the way.
Brilliant. Hey, you've stormed to the top of the league, Dave. 9 out of 9 up to now, so see if you can make it a clean sweep. Oh, right, question number 10. What is the total amount of your permanent transfer fees as a player? And I'll give you 50k either way.
Right, well... There is a discrepancy because I remember when Barry sold me, Terry Robinson told me that they were going to get some more money if I played so many games, and that was that 50k that I was talking about. Right. Now, I don't know whether they actually had to pay it in the end or not. So if I was to add that on, it would have been probably over 900 grand. So
is that your answer?
No.
You got 50 either way.
Right, well, so is it 850 in that? I'd say around about the 900, but I'd say a little bit lower. I'd say 880 or something like that, because I'm not sure about that 50 grand that they actually, whether it actually got transferred or not. So split it 925, 825, 875, split it down the middle.
Tell you what, you've got 875 spot on.
835.
875. Yeah. 875,
50
either way,
yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, that 50p either way.
Look at his fucking kipper.
I'm glad somebody got 10 out of 10 because it means my questions are quite competitive, so.
Yeah.
I'm happy now. Yeah, I am happy.
Yeah.
Excellent, Dave.
Is he
Colchester one. I was going to say Torquay, but I knew it was down in that area.
To be honest, looking at some of the questions, I mean, I won't know some of the answers. So, but yes, but on that, brilliant.
And you asked me a question about Super John. I know everything about Super John's career.
Yeah, well, yeah, Yeah, it's but yeah, well done. Brilliant. Made up.
Brilliant. No, I enjoyed that. That was good. Good questions. Yeah.
I'll get stick off the other players though for making it too easy.
Absolutely. Well, I'll tune in next week and watch and see how you go on with them.
Yeah, I'm impressed there, Dave. Superb. I'm glad somebody's got 10 out of 10 now.
I'm going on there. Who wants to be a millionaire in 2 weeks? So, Dave, I need your number.
If I win it, we'll share it.
Absolutely.
Excellent. Fair play. Yeah, thanks, Dave. Appreciate that.
No, brilliant. Good quiz. Thank you.
Thank you.
Right. So, obviously, you're doing, as I said before, you're doing a hell of a lot for the community. There's the Legends game, and there's you and Tony at Darien House.
Yeah. Yeah. We went for a visit there. To, they had a sports day for all the residents there, and me and Kells went on a team each and helped them, you know, throw a ball or push them in the wheelchairs and that. Trying to give them a bit of a different outlook on the day-to-day things they're doing. Do you know what? The staff there were absolutely brilliant that day. And I think we're only meant to go up for about half an hour. I think we're over there probably a couple of hours helping out and learning all about the families and speaking to them and what disabilities they have and what they go through on a day-to-day basis. And do you know what? It puts things into perspective. We are very, very lucky people when you've got your health. But it's the least we can do is go on and help and give our bit of time to those. They don't know us from Adam, do you know what I mean? They don't know we represented Bolton Wanderers, but it was their day and they absolutely loved it. And the parents who were there, they were absolutely fantastic. You hold your hands up to them because what they have to do on a day-to-day basis, on the outside, we never really get to see what the circumstances are, what they go through. And if we can give them a little bit of light, heartedness for the day, well, it's a job well done.
Yeah. I used to live in Chorley. I married a Chorley girl, unfortunately. Yeah. Well, that's another story. Whilst I was there, I became very good friends with Ian and Derek. Derek was Ian's brother, and it was Ian that set Darien House up.
Okay, right. Good story, yeah. Brilliant.
Yeah. Yeah, that and it just got too big for him, and then they obviously went to the people who could take it further.
Yes,
that's how the name Darien came about. The right, guy who,
I saw him.
The young lad who died called Derek, and Ian, his brother, sorted the cherry out. So right,
the infrastructure there and the staff are brilliant. They really are.
Yeah, it's fantastic. So I've got away. I've got a little clip for you.
Alan,
yeah,
just a quick one. I'll never be forgiven if I don't ask David this question because it's from tonight's sponsor. sorry about that. Sorry there, Joanne. Do you remember playing David against my dad in the Charlie V. Horwich town team matches in the 70s? And did you score?
God, I probably didn't score, but I remember playing at Charlie in district. Gosh,
he says, do you remember playing against her dad?
The Chorley district teams, who was he playing for?
I was playing for Horwich, yeah,
probably.
I didn't know she was talking about him.
Did I score badly or not?
Unfortunately, he did, yeah.
Hey, do you know what? I didn't score many, I'm surprised I didn't remember that.
I were in goal, Lord. Don't forget, I were in goal.
Yeah, but what you've got to say is that you saved three but only let one in.
Well, yeah, I did, but it were actually two that you scored, not one. Anyway, here's that little community. You were telling a story about John and Tony hiding under a desk. And the guy who were interviewing me could hardly keep a straight face, so I put together a little community clip up for you.
Brilliant. Look forward to watching. Everybody hurts sometimes. Everybody hurts some days.
I
I think by keeping myself fit, I've got 90 minutes inside me.
Next question is, have John and Tony got 90 minutes inside them?
I think they'll be roll on, roll off. Kells likes to stay in the centre circle, doesn't do much running. John McGinn will be in the 18-yard box scoring goals, and they'll probably give themselves 30, 40 minutes, have a bit of a breather and then come back on. But it's all for a great cause. Yeah, there's a serious side to it, but also the funny side of it as well. Everybody will give all their efforts for the full 90 minutes. Things into perspective of what we all have in our lives, but when you come to somewhere like this, it really hits home hard to what some of the parents have to go through and some of the disabilities of the children. But from Darien's House perspective, they do a fantastic job, and if we can help them in any way, as we have done today, we've had a fantastic afternoon. Long may it continue.
And as a father yourself, it'll obviously hit home that load of harder, won't it?
Yeah, it does. When you've got children of your own who lack any disabilities whatsoever, and you come here and you see what the parents have to go through on a day-to-day basis, what Darien House does is give the parents the respite to get a little bit of time alone and have time with the other parts of the family whilst the other children are here being looked after. It does put things into perspective, but again, it's a great cause, and if we can give a couple of hours of our time, it means the world to these people.
Think crack yourself, I think.
Well, still got it there, really?
Well, apart from that one I put over the bar.
Right. And there's the lovely lady in your life.
Joe, yeah, the artist.
That's the one that put the picture we were talking about, the white top picture, which is
superb. Well, that one there, the little one there on the right hand side. Joe did that a few years ago, and I said to her, "That is absolutely fantastic." And she said, "No, it's not that good." And I said, "You need to publicise that and continue with it." And once she'd done that one, Carla De La Vinci, who's a supermodel, and it's absolute, the quality of it is unbelievable. And I put that on my Facebook for her, and the response that she got, it's given her so much confidence to continue doing it. And that's her living now. That's what she does. She does portraits of people, animals, special occasions. And she's done some fantastic portraits with people. And I'm so proud of her. She's done brilliant. Everybody who does a commit, gets a commission, we then personally take it to them as well and present it to them. So she's inundated with requests, and she's a fantastic talent, and the patience she has to be able to, and the detail she goes into it, it's mind-blowing. It really is.
Excellent. Well, as I say, Joel did one for us free of charge, and I know she's very, very reasonable, but to do it free of charge and just send a picture, I thought it was an amazing Jestypot group. But I think my favourite one of all time is the dog. I love that dog picture there. It's so real.
The detail's fantastic, isn't it? And I mean, if you go on her art pages and you see some of the work she's done, it's mind-blowing. It really is. It's superb. And she's very, very reserved, is Joe. And She lets everybody else talk about it, but she doesn't give herself enough credit for what she's able to do there. And the family portrait there of all the grandchildren in that top left-hand one, the amount of time and effort she put into that, and I know the family were so grateful for it. And what once you see the quality of them, they are absolutely fantastic. She does brilliant.
Well, there's absolutely hundreds to look at, and a Facebook page is at the top there, and it's even if you don't buy one, it's worth looking at because
it's where it is. Just have a look at them, yeah.
But yeah, thank you. Absolutely fantastic.
Thanks, Al.
No, you're welcome, pal.
I'll tell her.
And here we are at present. I thought I'd just sum it all up with this picture that covers everything for me, really. Got you right. The player and take it like a bit of cheese, do you?
Yeah, well, my mate, who has his own Milk Round and dairy products, and he's obviously trying to promote his own business as well. And he was so kind, he said he came round, knocked on the door, said, "Yeah, David, I want you to try these cheeses." And I do like a bit of, on a Saturday night, if we sat having a meal or something, I like cheese and crackers. I don't have the wine because I'm not a wine, I don't drink at all, I don't drink alcohol, but anything like that, I'll certainly have a go at. Yeah, and there you've got the seriousness of the coaching side of it there from my time at Bolton. Great pictures and great memories from everything there.
Absolutely. You missed the trick there. You should have sold milk in the fridge.
Oh, he's already got one. Don't worry about that.
Yeah. Well, David, I tell you what, mate. You're just an unbelievable bloke. I've thoroughly enjoyed this stream. Yeah. We all regular events. We're working on a project at the moment for a drop-in centre for helping people in need and trying to get a player to go in and have a chat with them and get a bereavement counsellor in, addiction counsellor and job centre. And just for people to go when they're lonely. It wasn't my idea, this, actually. It was Kels's idea. But right. we've actually got a venue now, which is Andy. We'll talk about transport when it all comes up. There's a bit of work to go in it yet, but we've got a venue that's going to provide all the food and soup and soft drinks free. And if you want to... Really? If you want to find,
you can always count on myself, Kels, and begin to go and show our faces and do our little bit for that community. You don't even need to ask, you know, we'll be there and help you.
I know that, pal, but I mean, the events as well. I mean, if you came to one of the events, they're all Bolton through and through. Mm-hmm. You don't get mithered, you sit down, you don't get mithered, they come always shake your hand and say thank you. You know,
I don't mind, it's not about mithering it. Like people have watched us over all those years and they'll have questions and they're inquisitive and so they should be. And it's our honour to go and speak to people and get their thoughts on it rather than just our own single-mindedness of what happened. It's nice to see other people's thoughts and memories. And if we've made people happy over the last few years, why can't they come and share it with us? I think it's a great thing to do.
Well, it's like you said, right at the beginning, we still go on about Anfield and... you're one of our own, end of, and I've thoroughly enjoyed tonight. So, Darren, what have you got out to say?
Just thanks for coming on, Dave. It's been a pleasure speaking to you. I'm sure Twiggy's got that brown envelope with all that money in for all them bribed questions. superb. Hope to see you at one of our future events.
Yeah, no, thank you for having me on. I've really enjoyed it. And like I said, if I can do anything in return, you know, I'm always there for you.
Cheers.
Twiggy.
Yeah, just thanks, Dave. You know, shows you're an absolute gentleman, you know, to speak to, and it comes out your personality and all that. It's an absolute pleasure to have you on and get 10 out of 10 in my quiz as well. So well done.
But, no, listen, they were taxing questions, one or two guesses along the way, but... Yeah. That's sports and questions for you. No, I've really enjoyed it. It's been great again. Thank you.
Excellent. Thanks, awesome. David. Appreciate you.
And now because I got 10 out of 10, you won't be inviting me on again.
Well, I think I'm going to get a bit of flack off some players now.
Do you know what? Next time I come on, I'm going to do 10 questions for you.
Go on, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Dave, don't do that. He got 1 out of 10 last week.
That's a good show. We could get you on with Kells and Kells and McGinley and have a band tonight, couldn't we? That'd be superb.
I'll do that. Yeah.
Excellent.
I got 3 out of 10, by the way, Daz.
Did you? All right.
Yeah but admin's bailed you out twice.
No, he didn't. He didn't. He got 1 out of 10, and Gary Henshaw got that right.
Yeah, but you get your admins and players. It's 3 out of 10. Don't believe them, Dave. Don't believe
anyway,
them.
Anyway, Higgy, over to you, pal. Take it away.
David, do you do them big Americans ones with drink dispenser on?
Yeah.
Sorry, mate. Yeah, sorry. I'll DM you.
Yeah.
Thanks, Dave. It's been fantastic, mate. What a great night. What a great stream.
It's been great fantastic. Some fantastic questions from people who've been watching it as well. It's been great. Really enjoyed it.
Good.
Fantastic. And you know what?
Absolutely.
What you get with me, I'll always be honest with people. What you see is what you get with me. So.
Absolutely, yeah.
Brilliant.
Fantastic.
Dave, thanks. It's been an absolute pleasure. Love to your family. Stay safe and good luck with the white goods business. God bless you, mate.
Yeah. I'll be delivering them all over Bolton. If people want them, just give me a ring and I'll sort you out with something the best I can.
I might just get a microwave so I can have a brew with you. We'll see you soon. God bless.
Look, we can test it when everybody hurts sometimes. Everybody hurts some days. And say, here's to the ones that we got. Oh, cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today.